Satisfy your need for happiness through your own curiosity with The Ranveer Show.
I want to ask the economist in you this question. So the question I want to ask you is that when you're building, say, something like the Statue of Unity, the pro side argument, the argument for it is that when you build it up, it's able to make back the money in over the next 5 year span, but then that statue will stay for really long and therefore the income generated in that area will increase.
Look, I'm not overly worried about building statues and buildings. I worry about it when it becomes more edifice complex. The pharaohs of Egypt built pyramids. They didn't build it for the tourism that would come later on. There wasn't a cost-benefit analysis like that. It was, I want to be known for building these big buildings. And then you tend to overdo them. Mm. There's no cost-benefit analysis. I mean, look at what's happening in Egypt right now. Mr. Sisi, their president, is in trouble. Why? Because he has invested enormous amounts in this new city, which is some distance from Cairo. It's going to be a new, but it's absorbed an enormous amount of government funding. And the government is now, you know, essentially bankrupt. Similar things happened in Malaysia, in East Asia, when Malaysia was the poster child of trying to build a new capital city and so on. I think you have to be a little careful about too much building buildings for the future, which have no immediate use, but are, you know, going to become tourist destinations. Some, not bad, and maybe it builds up national spirit. Too many, and it becomes a monument to you rather than a monument that the nation can benefit from.
At the end of the day, we're all boys and girls who are trying to showcase our own might in this little world.
Right.
So I think when that feeling becomes overdone,
right,
that's when it can become a problem.
Right, right. I think that, so I'm not against. What I do think is we are a nation with limited resources. So we need to constantly ask, where is this money going, right? And, you know, one of the things we highlight in the book is, what should be our biggest source of shame? You know, so many things to feel proud of. Our biggest source of shame, I would argue, is the fact that 35% of our children have malnutrition, even today. That is a number which is worse than a number of countries in sub-Saharan Africa. How can that be? How can we allow that? When in fact the answers, the solutions are well known. And it's not that Indian kids are different and therefore, when you look at the same kids in the UK, they're perfectly well-nutritioned. Because malnutrition is going to hurt us, not just today, but 20 years from now when these kids join the labor force. If they haven't been able to study, think, learn, because their brains are not as well developed, because their body is not as well developed, it's going to hurt us. How can we permit this? We should be bringing this, if there's one project mode, project we should engage in, it is this. And measure it district by district, month, you know, year by year, how many kids are in this situation and tackle it. And the solutions are well known. They're well-known solutions in the rest of the world which tackled it in project mode.
So the solution in this case is you study another part of the world where this problem existed and then was solved and then apply it in India.
You can do that. You can also look at places where we've been successful in bringing it down within the country and ask, what did they do, and apply those best practices. But we need to do this. How can we be satisfied that we are making progress when we don't tackle this most difficult but horrible of problems?
What's the roadblock?
I don't know. I mean, the reality is government attention, you know, depends on where government's attention is.
Again, human angles here.
Human angles.
Like, where does your emotion naturally flow into?
Exactly. Exactly. I mean, you know, right. I think that's a sufficient explanation.
So effectively, you're never truly criticizing policy. You're criticizing human beings. One is never criticizing policy. One is criticizing human beings.
I mean, ultimately, so the Marxists would say your policies are driven by the technology and the attitudes, and you're sort of a prisoner of all that. But I would say there's human agency. Depending on who sort of leads and what their attention is on, you get different outcomes.
My highly optimistic and definitely innocent standpoint on this is that the entrepreneurs have the answers. And we just need to breed many, many, many more entrepreneurs in our country.
I think they do, but government has a role also, right? Because some of these things, there is no payoff for an entrepreneur. Now, if you're talking about social entrepreneurs, yes. And there are plenty of them in this country also who are trying to do different noble things on the social side without necessarily looking for a profit. But there may not be much profit immediately for somebody to rescue a child from malnutrition. But there's a very great urgency for a government to ensure that really a very, very small number of children suffer from it.
So here's my dream scenario, right? Like, I feel like my generation of entrepreneurs who've seen some successful bootstrap businesses will eventually do more businesses in life, sell to the world, make a lot of money, and dedicate their life post age 50 or 60 to actually helping solve the nation's problems that exist in, say, the 2040s and 50s. That's the dream scenario. And mostly all the entrepreneurs that I do meet even now who are on the same track are thinking along these lines. That there's no point of entrepreneurship if it doesn't lead to some kind of social impact.
Yeah, but the solution you're proposing is 20 years from now.
Yes.
When these guys we need a solution today because these problems will get entrenched 20 years from now. I mean, one of the worries we have to have is that if we don't find jobs for all the millions who are coming into the labor force, the crores who are coming into the labor force, what we have is conflict. I mean, think about what's happening in Manipur. At the face of it is Métis and Kukis. But in reality, it's also about access to jobs, reservations. Who gets reservations? Who gets those benefits? Because there are too few private jobs going around. If private jobs were plentiful, who would care about government jobs? And there was a time we were seeing a lot of private jobs coming in the liberalization, the 90s and the early 2000s. Somehow we've run out of steam. We need a new generation of reforms that enable that job creation, right? So, I mean, I think that we need answers today. Now, we need answers also for the medium term. So that's where your answer comes in, that we need to enable the kind of entrepreneurship that creates those answers. But we need immediate answers, we need medium-term answers, we need long-term answers. And I think there is a role for the private sector in all three, but there has to be attention paid to this on a war footing.
Again, this whole conversation that we've had, and we're entering that last rung of the conversation where we'll talk about manufacturing. So, but everything that we've spoken about boils down to education and entrepreneurship for me. Like, that's what I've gained from this whole conversation, that almost all of the nation's problems can be solved through these two.
No, I would say, let me not minimize the role of government. That the government can be a disabler or an enabler. And what we need is an enabling government, which will, you know, allow all these forces to play a role. And that requires a government which places the right priorities on these different issues, but also creates the right framework, the right environment. And, you know, I think if you have all those elements, now some of that, that's what's important. That's, again, what we write about in the book. It requires actual change in the nature of government. That without that, we may find it hard. Policies don't just happen. Policies have to be incentivized. And if government is of a certain sort, those kinds of policies don't get incentivized. So how do we incentivize the right policies? You know, you said education. How do we incentivize much more of a focus on getting education right, on getting healthcare right, on getting nutrition right? And that requires also some deep-rooted changes in the nature of our government.
Have you ever suggested all this to government officials or politicians? Like, everything that you're saying on this podcast, yeah. Is this the first time you're publicly saying these things?
No, I've said it for some time. the book is a way of putting it together in a coherent way. So people see all the pieces together. Why are you saying this? Why are you saying that? How does it fit together? And I think once you see all of that, then you say, aha, okay, this is a model which is worth looking at. Now, you can of course pick and choose from within the model, but we're saying it all hangs together.
If you enjoyed today's clip, make sure you check out these curated playlists that we've made especially for you related to the subject that was spoken about in this clip.